It just occurred to me that this song might not be suitable for work. And before they get to the good lyrics, I'm going to turn it down. Sorry. It looks like the session has started, so perfect timing. That was The Replacements, in case anybody was curious. That was from their album called Let It Be from 1984 or so. Has anybody heard of The Replacements before? All right. So, welcome to MMS in Las Vegas and the Sysinternals Primer MMS 2013 edition. My name is Aaron Margosis. I'm a principal consultant with Microsoft Consulting Services, specifically in the cybersecurity services team, which I joined a few months ago. I'm also the co-author of a book that I'll talk about in just a moment, actually right now. Co-author of the Sysinternals Administrator's Reference with Mark Rusinovich. You can see our names in here. You can see his a lot more easily than mine, which is good. One thing I do want to mention about this book, it came out a couple years ago. It is the most comprehensive, accurate, and complete documentation about the Sysinternals utilities. I assume you're here because you already know what the Sysinternals utilities are. I do want to point out that this is not the same as Windows Internals. There is a series of books that Mark Rusinovich is a co-author of called Windows Internals that goes back to the very first days of Windows NT. And that is all about the guts of the operating system, how the kernel works, how the executive works, and all this other kind of stuff. This is the Windows Sysinternals Administrator's Reference. It's all about the Sysinternals utilities. So there's a full chapter about Process Explorer, a full chapter about Process Monitor, auto runs, et cetera. There's also a case of the unexplained section in the back that shows how a lot of these tools have been used to solve real-world problems. How many of you have ever been to a case of the unexplained talk by Mark Rusinovich? If you get to, he's not at this conference, if you ever get to Tech Ed, make sure to go to that session. Or you can also see it online, and I'll have links for you later on that you can go to find those. So the Sysinternals Primer series has actually been going on for a number of years. This is my first MMS, but I've been at Tech Ed a number of times, and we started delivering these Sysinternal Primer sessions a number of years ago. And the idea behind the Sysinternals Primer was not to tell stories about troubleshooting, but to dive into the tools and just show as much as we could about the utilities. So here are a ton of features, as much as we can fit in, about Process Explorer, Process Monitor, PS Exec, et cetera. And as you can see, in 2010, we did three utilities. In 2011, several more. And last year, we got really nerdy and showed how the Sysinternals utilities can be used to delve into some low-level stuff in the operating system, as well as talk about some of the lesser-known utilities. So this year, and for the first time at MMS, this Sysinternals Primer is going to be all about what is new and updated since the book came out. So I'm assuming that you've all read this book, because that's the starting point. We assume that you already read everything in the book, and now you want to know what's changed since then. Is that good? Everyone okay with that? For those of you who haven't, you can get it online, download it, read it right here really quickly. I'll wait a few minutes so you can catch up with the rest of us. So, one of the things that's new that took both Mark and me by surprise was we found out that they published this in Russian. The Sysinternals Administrator's Reference came out in Russian. And you can tell, actually, that Mark was taken by surprise by this and had no idea this was coming out. Does anybody see the evidence that this was a surprise to Mark Rusinovich? The names are in the same font size. All right, so the book came out in 2011, summer of 2011, and you know, Mark keeps the website updated, keeps issuing new versions of the tools, updating them with new features. There's been a couple of new tools since the book came out. But how quickly did the book start becoming obsolete or out of date? And here's the blog post where on the Sysinternals blog where we announced the release of the book. we are excited and proud to announce the release of the official Sysinternals book. Okay? This is July 2011. In the same blog post, they announce a major update to Process Explorer with a bunch of features that aren't in the book. So at the same time we're announcing, here's the new book with everything, we immediately make it obsolete. List DLLs got updated at the same time. The book is still accurate. Everything in there is still completely accurate as far as the features are concerned, because none of the features have been removed. However, it's no longer complete. And this session is bringing that up to date. You can think of it like an early draft of second edition, assuming I ever consent to go through that process again. I'm not going to talk about any of the bug fixes. A lot of the releases just involve bug fixes to the utilities. I'm going to be talking about new features. One of the things that's changed is some of the utilities have gained additional support for Windows X64, 64-bit versions of Windows. Now, some utilities like Process Monitor, if you run them on a 64-bit system, they have to run 64-bit code. It needs a 64-bit driver, et cetera. But we also want to be able to run on 32-bit. So the way Mark does that is you download and you run this executable that's 32-bit. And when it detects this is a 64-bit system, it has 64-bit versions of the program embedded within it. It extracts those out and then runs those. So that's what he does for Process Monitor, I believe ProcDump, actually maybe not, Process Monitor, and a few others where it absolutely has to run 64-bit code. Some of the others, we don't need to go to that extent. However, the 32-bit versions originally did not work correctly on 64-bit because when a 32-bit process tries to touch the System32 folder, for example, it automatically gets redirected to the SysWOW64 folder. And likewise, with certain parts of HKEY local machine, it gets redirected to the WOW6432 node registry key. And so it's not the utilities were not manipulating the same data that the operating system components were, because they're running 64-bit code and not getting redirected. So what some of these utilities have been done to update, to work correctly on 64-bit, is simply to turn off that redirection. There's APIs that are available that programs can use to say, don't redirect me, I want this file, and then it can manipulate 64-bit stuff while still being a 32-bit program. And these utilities have been updated that way. A number of utilities have had Windows 8 support added. In some cases, it's simply looking for, you know, understanding the new security attributes that are available in Windows 8. It may be the new file system control codes and things like that. In some cases, though, some of the utilities that monitor events and use ETW, event tracing for Windows, Windows 8 adds new support to allow ETW subscribers to coexist better so they don't step on each other. And so the utilities have been updated so that they don't get, they don't interfere with perf tracing and things like that. So it's always a good idea, if you have a folder of Sysinternals utilities and they're all from 2010, you should update them on a regular basis. There's bug fixes as well as new features coming out all the time. One of the questions that always comes up, particularly within Microsoft, is can I get Sysinternals utilities for Windows RT? Windows RT is the new version of Windows that runs on ARM processors. It does not allow desktop apps except those that have specifically been signed, such as Office versions of Office that have been specifically built and approved by the Windows team. And the answer to this is no. They're limiting as much as possible desktop apps, Win32 apps that run on the Windows RT platform. So if you have, for example, one of the Surface RT devices, there are no Sysinternals utilities available for that. But the Windows team assures us that there's no need to run Sysinternals utilities on Windows RT. I think that's great. And that's all I'm going to say about it, because I like continuing to be employed. All right. So let's dive into what is new. Process Explorer, as you saw in the opening slide, Process Explorer got a major update as soon as the book came out. So it's still accurate, but no longer complete. Here's a list of what has changed. And I think I'm just going to go straight into demo mode to show some of these. OK, so here we are on Windows 8. Here's my Windows 8 desktop. And let me see, I need my start menu. Where is it? There it is. WinKeyR. Magic. It brings everything back. I'm going to run Process Explorer. Now, when I install the Sysinternals utilities, I just copy them into a new folder, program files /sysinternals, and then I add that to my path. So I can use Sysinternals utilities from anywhere. So Process Explorer /E says run this program elevated. That's not a new feature. It's been like that for a while. Now, one of the things you see right away is these color bands that show the different types of processes. So pink indicates these are services. The purple says these are things running under the same security context, or the same user account as Process Explorer, et cetera. The color bands no longer go all the way across. And that's because the CPU column, the private bytes column, and the working set column are now heat maps, which is best demonstrated by demonstrating. So here is a program, just a dummy program that allocates memory and crashes and consumes CPU and things like that. So let's allocate some memory. Commit. Free it afterwards. And we can't see the process. I think 5 gig would do something there. What happened here? You know what? This is the wrong version. This is the 32-bit version. Excuse me a second. Okay, let's find that process. Okay, it's right down here, right below the selection. And now I'm going to allocate memory. There we go. See how it turned darker yellow? When numbers go past a certain threshold, they start to get darker and darker and darker. So release it, and the color goes back. Let's do 8 gig. Hopefully I don't kill this at any point. Okay, now that's just private bytes. That's private address space, but it's not actually loading into RAM. Let's see what happens when we perform read operations on that, and we'll see the memory being read, and that will bring it into the working set of the process. So we'll see two things happen here. You can see the working set column getting darker and darker and darker, and the CPU column gets darker as well, because it's consuming CPU cycles to read that data in. That was a lot of memory. Maybe I should have backed off on that. While that's going on, I'll point out that we also have, okay, so it finally completed. The CPU is settled down. The working set is still very high. So the idea here with the heat map is you can very quickly now find what the hotspots are, what's really consuming the CPU without having to interpret the numbers and things like that. We also have a new highlighting color for Windows 8 for what are called immersive apps. Let me go over here and start the Maps program. Okay. And come back over here, and it's not showing as immersive for some reason. But it did go suspended. Okay. Explorer is showing as immersive. Immersive means, you know, the new modern WinRT application. So it'll show, it's supposed to show as this blue color. I have to try this one more time. Let's try the mail app. We'll come back over here. Yes, so here's the mail app, and it is light blue, and it just exited. Oh, because I don't have an internet connection. But the other thing you see here is the map app, which is a WinRT app, a modern app, ran for a while, and then when focus was taken away, it was suspended. That's one of the attributes of WinRT apps, is when they lose focus, they get to run for about 5 more seconds, and then they're suspended. The idea here being to conserve power. They need to be specially registered in order to continue to run in the background, and most should not do that. Because of this, though, we have the gray color, which indicates this app is suspended, as well as it now says suspended in the CPU column. Another new feature here with create dump. The create dump feature has been around for a bit, and what's changed in it now is that if you create a dump for a 32-bit process on 64-bit Windows, it'll actually create a 32-bit dump instead of a 64-bit dump. 32-bit dumps are a lot easier to handle than 64-bit dumps. Another feature I really like a lot is the update to the Find dialog. Let me create something here. Oh, here's another start menu trick. How many of you have seen WinKeyX? This is really powerful. It's like we never lost the start menu at all. Knew that would get a laugh, unfortunately. Let's look for some text. Okay, so I'm looking for the name Abby, the text Abby in here. Now, this dialog always showed you the processes that had a handle containing that text, the process ID, the type, and the name. The type used to just tell you, is this a DLL or a kernel handle of some kind, right? Process Explorer has a view that shows you all the handles that a process owns and all the DLLs that are loaded into a process, and all it would tell you is this is a DLL or a handle. Now, for handle types, it actually tells you what kind of handle it is. So it can tell you, for example, this is a file or a token, so you can more quickly identify the handles that you're interested in, the ones you're looking for. So if you know you're looking for a token, now you can see here that these are the tokens, as opposed to some other type of handle. The process details tab has been updated. So ASLR types, this does not have that information in there for some reason. Okay, so ASLR, address space layout randomization, in Windows 8 supports different types of ASLR, and those are called out here on the image tab now. Another new feature is the auto start location. So Mark has introduced some of the auto runs feature set into Process Explorer. So for example, Windows Explorer has an auto start location. This is what launches Windows Explorer every time you log on. HK Local Machine Software, Microsoft Windows NT current version, WinLogon shell, and Explorer will take you to that location in the registry where that's configured. So some auto runs technology built into Process Explorer now. Okay, the security tab, let's see what we can do here. It will show you, this one doesn't have it. Let's find one of those. Yeah, this is a better one. So the Windows 8 WinRT apps have new security attributes, capabilities, and other stuff that they've not been documenting very well. Those are all in here. Another feature that's really good, though, is now these columns are sortable. So you can group all the NT authority and built-in groups. And if you are on a domain like mine, where you're a member of a ton of different groups, being able to sort by them is a really valuable feature, as well as what are the different types of flags that are on these things. Is this an app container SID or a capability SID? The services tab for services now offers a restart option for services that can be restarted. Find one that can be. Yeah, so restart is a new feature that's available there. That's useful. The threads tab can show you the stack of .NET processes. So now, for those of you who work with developers or are developers, you can look at the call stack for managed code and see the a sensible reading of that material too. The system information dialog now has GPU, graphics processing unit, data as well. So this is new as of, I think this was the one that came out right after the book came out. So it can show you the hardware that's affiliated with graphics processing and how that's being consumed. That also appears in a number of other places. There's new columns and a number of other locations where that information is surfaced. And I have to show you, as you may have noticed there, this is the old system information dialog, right? With the Windows NT4 style, you know, electric colors on a black grid with green lines. And now it looks like this. Ooh, it's modern and sleek and pastel. How many of you prefer it this way? Okay. Yeah. Let's see, how shall I put this? I sat down with Mark and talked to him for a long time about it, and I explained all the rational, deep technical reasons why the old color scheme was better. And he listened to me intently for the full 15 minutes, and when I was done, he said, "Have you gained weight?" One thing you can do, if you don't like that, is configure colors now gives you the option to change the background color. So for example, you can change the background color of the graphs to black so it looks like that. But that's all you can do. You can't make it look like the original. But Mark promises for any of you who don't like the new color scheme, he'll give you a full refund. Moving on to Process Monitor. Process Monitor has not gotten nearly as much update as Process Explorer, but there are some really cool features in here. So let's get rid of this. And Procmon, which always requires elevation. Can you see that in the back okay? Those of you in the back, can you read the top line for me, please? Can you see the E at the top of the chart? Let me find the font dialog here. Let's boost this up a bit. I thought that worked. That's a little better. Okay. So one of the features that's been in here for a long time is the ability to highlight items. So you can highlight everything that matches a particular value or begins with a particular value. And one of the things you could also do was navigate between them, between the highlighted events, by going to the properties dialog, clicking, you can go down to the next event one at a time by clicking this. If you check the next highlighted box, it goes down to the next highlight. That's been there for a long time. What's new, though, is now you can do it without the properties dialog by using F4 to go down, and Shift F4 to come back. So better navigation. You can also take a highlight filter and turn it into an include filter. So you just go to the highlight dialog, click Make Filter. It removes it from the highlight dialog, from the highlight filter, and turns it into an include filter. So now it's only showing you the events that you had previously been highlighting. But one of the really cool features is bookmarking. So it used to be that if you found a particular event of interest that didn't have anything really unique about it, but you knew that was the one you wanted, and you wanted to be able to navigate back to that quickly, it was kind of hard. Like maybe you could, you know, select the time and do a highlight filter on the time, but that can conflict with other settings that you have. So what Mark added is the ability to bookmark specific events. So an arbitrary event, you select it, you press Control B, B as in bold, B as in bookmark, and now it stands out. You can go down and select another and bookmark that, and bookmark another one. And now you can navigate between them with F6 until you get to the end of the list, and reverse that with Shift F6. And if you save this PML file, save it to a PML file, the PML file retains the bookmark information. So you save it with the bookmarks, you load it back in later, the bookmarks are still present. The last thing I want to show you here in Process Monitor is, let me start a new process. Okay, and stop that and search for process start. The process start event now includes additional data that wasn't there before, specifically the current directory at the time the process was started and the entire environment block. So this is the environment variables that are being inherited by this new process at the time it starts. So basically, that's it for Process Monitor, with one big exception that I'm going to talk about in a little bit, and that is that procdump can now feed data into Process Monitor. So that will, and I'll show you that in a little while. Process Monitor, with the help of procdump, can now monitor more than just file and registry and process activity. It can also capture everything that procdump is monitoring, CPU, memory, etc. I'll come back to that with a demo in a little bit. The next chapter, chapter 5, is auto runs. This one's had a number of updates as well. Let me start that up. There's the end user license agreement. Thank you, Microsoft lawyers. I love the lawyers, you know, really. Insert lawyer joke here. And just so you can, actually, this might not matter too much for this one. Okay, so one of the new features is, it can't be everything. Windows entries hidden. Oh, this system doesn't have a whole lot on it, that's why. Okay, well, anyway, one thing you could always do in the past was right-click on an entry and do jump to entry, and it would take you to where that auto start entry was configured. So in this particular case, this is one that's configured in HQ Local Machine Software, WOW 6432 node, Microsoft Active Setup Install Components. Clicking jump to entry will launch RegEdit and navigate to that location. What is new is jump to image. That will take you to where the executable lives. So instead of going into the registry, this is going, it's launching Windows Explorer and taking you to and selecting winmail.exe, which isn't on this system. That's awesome. So there's an auto start entry point for a non-existent program. Is this one there? Nope. Excellent. Okay. Services, this one has to be there. Oh man. Oh boy, I wish Mark were here. I'd love to show him this. Huh. This is really fun. I have to take a note of this one. Bug report time. Okay, anyway, additional features include the active filter. Now, you can filter AutoRun's data to show everything or hide everything that is from Windows or hide everything that's from Microsoft, and then also have signatures verified. The default is just hide the Windows entries without checking signatures. It shows you in the status bar now what the active filter actually is. So if you go into options, filter options, verify code signatures, hide Microsoft entries, so you can tell more quickly, you know, what you're looking at and what you're not looking at. Another new feature is if you save AutoRun's data to a file, the default format is .arn, which is a proprietary format, a binary format of AutoRun's. Mark now sets a file association with that, so when you see a .arn file, you can just double-click it, and it'll open up in AutoRun's. And finally, there is AutoRun's C, which is the command line version, and it has added some new command line options, and in particular, with, this is too big now, with the user option where you specify a user, you can use star instead of the username to specify show the auto start entry points for all users on the system, not just one specific user. Are we having fun yet? Okay, next, PS Tools. How many of you have ever used PS Exec? Okay, how many of you are hackers? Because that one always seems to turn up in the hacker tool list. So, you know, how many of you work in places where you download the Sysinternals suite and the antivirus or the firewall or proxy or whatever says, no, you can't download that because that has malware in it? Yeah, I have customers where that happens all the time. It's royal pain. So anyway, PS Exec, I'm going to show you something that's not been released yet. Hopefully it'll come out very soon. It's actually PS Exec 2.0, which is a good thing because he was running out of space. He was up to PS Exec 1.98. It was like, you can't add many more minor features to this thing before you're going to run out. So it's now 2.0, and the new feature, and by the way, you are the first in the world to see this outside of Microsoft. Actually, I did an internal version of this talk in February, and I did not show this. So I'm going to do Windows X, do Command Prompt Admin, because you need to be admin in order to do what I'm about to do. If you do PS Exec -S, that says run this thing as local system, and I'm going to run Command Prompt. You can see here in Process Explorer that the way that works is it creates a new service, psexeservice.exe, which then launches the command. It does the same thing when you want to launch something on a remote computer. Okay, so you want to run something, you can use psexec --/ computer name, as long as you have admin rights on that machine, to run something remotely. The way it does it is it installs this service on the remote machine, psexeservice, and then tells it, launch this program. Okay? And the service name has always been PSExe service. The new feature is you can change the name of the service and the executable. Oh, dear. I did that from within the non-interactive session. It's probably prompting for a EULA in the non-interactive desktop. So I have to kill that. Okay, let's try that again. PS exec dash R some other name. Okay, now you see here that service no longer exists. Okay, the target program ended, the service shut itself down and unregistered itself. So I'm gonna use the name some other name dash S CMD. You can see here now, instead of PSExe service, it's some other name.exe. And it's the one launching it. Why would you do this? Maybe you don't want someone on the other side knowing you're running PSExec. Although, if you look at the, anyone who can look at the attributes of this thing will see that it is the PSExec service from Sysinternals. Another reason might be, you've got a bunch of these sessions going on at once. Now, PSExec is designed to support multiple clients coming in at one time. It's supposed to keep track of, I've had two requests and one has ended, so I don't exit yet. But there seem to be some timing issues which haven't been figured out yet. And so this allows you to just say, this session we're using this name, this other PSExec session we're using this other name. And so they won't collide with one another. So you should be able to do, should I do a demo? I haven't demoed this yet. Let me try this and just see how much trouble I can get myself into here. So we'll do, while that first one is running, PSExec, this will be a bug report if it doesn't work. MMS 2013. Dash S CMD, and come on, work, yes. So now I've got two separate PSExec sessions going on at the same time. So that's PSExec 2.0 coming out one of these days. I can't promise when, but since I'm announcing it here, I think it'll probably be sooner rather than later. Applaud really loudly if you want him to release it soon, because maybe he'll see the recording. And where was it? Yes, okay, so the next one I want to talk about, PS Password. The book is actually accurate and complete. The reason I'm bringing this up, though, is it was accurate and complete before PS Password itself was. PS Password's a utility that's been around for a really long time. I think Mark first wrote it back in the 90s. It's for setting a password. It's a command line program that lets you set a password on a user account. And in the process of writing the book, this is a very detailed book, over 450 pages. When I say accurate and complete, I mean we spent a lot of time making sure everything in there was completely accurate. And while we were doing that and reviewing the command line options on some of these utilities, we started rethinking, you know, is this really the best way to do it? And PS Password had some stuff that, you know, didn't work well with domain accounts and things like that. So we discussed how can we improve that. And so it got a major redo. Totally different syntax for domain accounts and local accounts. But then, you know, the book came out in July of 2011 or June of 2011. And the utility didn't get updated until October of 2011. But, you know, so it's since the book came out, but the book is actually accurate and complete. What is completely new, what's not in the book at all, is a new utility called PS Ping, which came out in October. PS Ping extends what you can do with the built-in Ping utility. Mark thought that that thing was just not good enough, and the third-party stuff on the market was just not usable enough, too hard to use, and didn't serve all the things he wanted to do. And so he created PS Ping and added it to the PS Tools suite. Ping shows you stuff to a very low, to a fairly high resolution. This will show you network performance to 1/100th of a millisecond resolution. It has the standard ICMP ping tech functionality to just, you know, do an ICMP echo and things like that. It can also do TCP connection latency, TCP round trip time, TCP bandwidth, and it can generate histograms. So the usage is very much like the one that comes in the box. PS ping, you can just do PS ping, tell it where you want to, what you want to test, and it'll start doing the ICMP thing and try to get a response back. There's a bunch of other options, including setting the interval. So instead of pinging once every second, you can change it to every 5 seconds or no interval, so just one after the other after the other. There's some other command line options there I'm not going to discuss right now. The next thing I want to talk about is TCP ping. The command line syntax here is simply, it's exactly the same as the ICMP ping, except you specify a TCP port after the server name. Okay, so now, instead of sending these echo requests using ICMP, it establishes a TCP connection, which tends to be more what you're probably interested in anyway, because ICMP doesn't really offer a whole lot of functionality. And in fact, let me demo this really quickly. Assuming we have an internet here, if I do psping www.microsoft.com, well, actually, let me make sure we have microsoft.com first. Yes, we do. Microsoft homepage. I'm not going to wait for it to come up. Okay, so if I do psping www.microsoft.com, what do you think I'm going to get back? Did I hit enter? I didn't hit enter. So nothing happens until I hit enter, and thank you, lawyers. Request timed out. Why is that? Because most machines don't respond to ICMP anymore. Routers will block it, firewalls block it, host-based firewalls don't respond to ICMP. So control C that. I'll do a TCP connect instead, Microsoft.com:80, the HTTP port. And this will show how long does it take to establish a TCP connection. Drop the connection, do it again. Drop the connection, do it again, and show here I've got 37 milliseconds to establish a TCP connection. And that'll work, assuming that it's up and running. I'm not going to demo these next ones, but TCP latency and bandwidth. The idea here is establish a TCP connection to a remote server, and then test how long it takes for data to transfer back and forth across that established connection. Now, the only way you can do that is if you have something running on the server that knows how to respond to what you're asking. And so PSPing offers that. PSPing-S, you run that on the server side, and you specify the interface that you want to use and the port. Okay, so if you've got, you'll probably have multiple IP addresses, you specify the IP address that you're going to be trying to connect to, and then the port that you're going to open up. Then on the client, you do PSPing and point it to that destination and the port, and you specify these other options to say, how many, how much data do you want to send back and forth. Actually, I meant to show a couple other things in this earlier demo. So let me just go back and do that real quick. So we did PSPing-80. I wanted to show -I0 that you can do one after the other after the other. -N20. I'm going to do 20 of them. And finally, I want to do -H to generate histograms of the data that it captured. So it takes the upper and lower bounds and then shows you where most of that data came in. And this is tab delimited, so you can put it straight into Excel. The other options, the latency and the bandwidth, also offer the option to do histograms and how many buckets to use. So TCP latency is just simply how long does it take for data to go back and forth. The bandwidth one floods that channel. It saturates the channel, so you're sending, you've got multiple threads hitting it all at once and trying to see how much, how long does it take to get, a large amount of data through. So all that is built into PSPing, the second most recent utility. A new utility just came out in the last week or two, and I'll demonstrate that much later on in the session. Okay, process and diagnostic utilities. VM map, proc dump, debug view, live KD, list DLLs, and handle. So VM map is a utility. Because all of you have read the book, you know that VM map shows the virtual memory space of an application. So let me fire that up. So let me select a different process first. Let's do this Explorer process. One of the things that's changed is for image sections, it shows the ASLR status of the individual sections, the individual regions, because you may have some parts of your process where ASLR is enabled and other parts where it's not. And we've actually had security issues around we thought we were ASLR protected, but there was some component that was loaded in that was always at a predictable location in memory, and we'd run into trouble with that. So this can show you whether ASLR is enabled for each of the different memory regions for images. There's also a new category of memory in here, and that is unusable, memory that is unusable. And if you open up your copy, the latest copy of Windows Internals, and look at the different types of memory and try to find what is unusable, it's not in there. This is a recently defined category as far as these tools are concerned. And the idea of what's unusable is when you use the Windows APIs to allocate memory, it always does it on 64K boundaries. Okay, so memory managers will allocate some big chunk and then allocate little pieces from that. So you don't have to worry about it there. But anything that's using the Windows APIs to allocate memory always gets something on a 64K boundary. So if you allocate 32K of RAM, the other 32K is no longer accessible to the process, right? Because there's no way to get to it unless you resize that buffer. And so what VMMap will show you is here's how much memory is now unusable. It's in the virtual address space, but it cannot be accessed. And the last thing to show you here is, and for this I'm going to use my sample app, do a refresh, and come over here and allocate some memory. And I'm going to leak it this time. I'm not going to read it. Virtual alloc. Do a refresh to get new data. So the VM map will capture a sequence of memory states and report them to you. 2000. Let's do 100 or 1000. Refresh. And let's do a big one here. Let's do 7,000. Allocate that. Refresh. The timeline used to show the working set memory, the history of the working set of the process. Now it shows committed memory, which is a lot more useful because working set can be, is not as predictable. Working set is how much of it is in RAM. Other processes may push your processes memory out to a virtual file, right? So this is showing stuff that is under the process's control. If it's leaking memory, you're going to see it here. Working set, not so predictable. So that's the latest feature of VM map. The next one I want to talk about is proc dump. Proc dump has gone through more revisions than any other utility in the Sysinternals suite. It's actually gone through, what do I have up there, 2 major updates and 4 minor updates. And this is largely due to the work of an engineer in the Windows division named Andrew Richards. He used to work with Exchange. Now he's in the Windows division with OEM. And he has contributed a ton of code. ProcDump used to be about 1,000 lines of code when the book came out. Now it's 9,000. So he's done a heck of a lot of work. And it's way too much to list on this sheet right here. So this is what ProcDump looked like when the book came out. Here are the new command line options. Dash E has been there. It monitors acceptance. So let me go back and just mention what ProcDump is for. How many of you have ever used ProcDump? Okay, so most of you are not familiar with this. ProcDump will monitor a process, and when it reaches a certain, when certain criteria are met, like it starts consuming too much CPU, or it reaches a memory threshold, or some other performance counter has been hit, it captures a user mode dump of that process and saves it to disk. And you can do this, you can configure it to capture a sequence. So, the CPU goes up, capture five dumps 1 second apart, or, just keep capturing dumps. And then you can use this to figure out why is the process misbehaving. So dash E says capture a dump whenever an exception is hit. What's been added to that is now it can also monitor managed exceptions, so things happening in managed applications, which it couldn't do before. Dash F says look for specific exceptions rather than any exception. So you can skip all the minor exceptions you don't care about and then trigger on the one that you're concerned with, like a file exception or something like that. Dash G says only capture the native exceptions and ignore the managed process exceptions. Dash L will monitor debug output from the process. So if it's spewing out debug output that would be viewed with a tool like a debugger or debug view, you can now see that with ProcDump. In addition, dash X, the command line parameters for dash X have been rearranged so that they can be used in more more things like, for example, to use as a just-in-time debugger. So the command line option, that one's simply the order of the parameters. So if you have any scripts that are using it, be aware that the new versions change the order of those parameters. But what it can also do is you can use it to launch a WinRT app, a Windows 8 modern app. So you can now launch those with ProcDump, monitor them, and monitor the exceptions. And I'll demo that in a little bit. Dash I allows you to make ProcDump the just-in-time debugger that gets launched when a process crashes. So you can have it capture its dumps, and the work that's been done in it makes it a lot more valuable than a lot of the other ones that are out there. And finally, dash C has been available to monitor for CPU threshold being reached, dash M for memory usage going past a certain threshold, and P when a performance counter goes above a certain level. Those have been extended with CL, ML, and PL. In some cases, you may have an app where it is normal for it to be at a high CPU level and abnormal for it to drop to a low CPU level. So what these allow you to do is monitor if the CPU level drops below a threshold, capture a dump at that point. Similarly, for memory and for performance counters. Let me do some demo on this. Okay, so first of all, I want to point out that you just run ProcDump. It shows you all the command line options, and then there's more. So you can do ?-E to see examples, which is really helpful because one of the examples I want to show you is too hard to remember from memory, and that is how do you monitor a modern application. So we'll do that with dash X, and we're going to launch, because the modern apps are not exe files, right? You don't launch an exe. You do something, you interact with the process lifetime manager and tell it, please launch this thing, and it kind of loads like a DLL. And that can't be. Where am I? That is really weird. Oh, I know what I'm doing wrong. I'm doing this in PowerShell, and it is doing things with some of the command line options. I'll do it from a command prompt instead. Yeah, that's better. Heart attack averted. Okay, so go back here, and there's supposed to be a proc dump window somewhere. Oh, it is not my day. Sorry? It shouldn't be needed. That launches. There it is. Okay, so this is a managed app. You're seeing .NET, .NET exceptions being raised. Okay, so you can trigger on any of these. In this case, what I did, though, is I set a filter to blank. So although we're monitoring all the exceptions, we're not actually creating a dump at any point here. But we see this file not found exception, and I'm curious what that might be. So let me show you this really cool new feature. What I'm going to do is launch procmon. Okay, go back and... let me stop that, clear that filter. Close that app, we'll do it again. So one of the things that has been available in Process Monitor is an API for sending it data. So you can send your own events from your application to procmon and add it to the output. So you can have a trace in your program that says, you know, I'm trying to debug this thing, tell procmon, so you can see in the middle of all the stuff your program is doing to report an event to procmon. And I did the same mistake that Andrew Richards did when he demoed this the last time. And he turned off procmon and didn't turn it back on. Third time is the charm. Start process monitor. Okay, now all this output is actually being sent to Process Monitor. And it's actually turning up in something that's normally hidden, profiling events. Profiling events normally show you procmon generated events that show the state of the process and all the data that's accumulated. If you hide those, though, exclude process profiling. Now you get the debug output profiling. This is the stuff that's being sent from process monitor. And so here we can find this file not found exception. And let's highlight that. And now we know there was a file not found exception. We don't know what the file was. We turn file events back on. And let's get rid of the success events, exclude those, and that noise event. And here you see name not found, combase DLL, combase DLL, no such file. This is probably, it's going to be one of these triggering that event. There was a more interesting one that happened when I was working on this before. But anyway, you get the idea here that now, in addition to monitoring file and registry activity, you can also monitor process failure events. Let me show another example here. Hide all these, and we'll monitor. procdump-c, say 90% per CPU, vertmem test 64. Okay, now it's waiting for this process to start consuming CPU. And when it does, it starts reporting this. And eventually, it's going to generate a dump if it goes for 10 seconds. Here you can see the exact same output showing up in process monitor. So you can integrate that with all the other events that are going on in the system. For those of you who remember the days of FileMon and RegMon, where you had, here's the file events, here's the registry events, and no way to integrate them, and then PROCMON gave us the ability to get all that in one place, and now you can add a ton more information by combining with PROCDUMP. Debug view, the book is accurate and complete, except that one new command line option is coming that hasn't come out yet, but for those of you who were using debug view, which captures debug output spewed out by applications and kernel mode drivers, the command line syntax got totally redone as a result of the book. So instead of this client and server name that didn't make any sense before, it's now agent and viewer. The dash Q option is the new one that'll be coming out sometime soon. We also added options to tell debug view up front to what kind of events to monitor. LiveKD has a dash O option. LiveKD is something that allows you to get a snapshot of kernel mode memory and to open it in the debugger and see what's going on in kernel memory, but it operates on a snapshot. It has a dash O option. It's had a dash O option for a long time that allows you to capture that to a dump file. Grab the whole thing and save it to a dump file. The problem with it is it would do it while the system was continuing to run. So it would be going through kernel pages, saving stuff to disk, while the kernel is continuing to change. So you wouldn't necessarily have a consistent view. With the new dash M option, they have taken advantage of some operating system features to capture a true snapshot, so the data is actually one consistent point in time. I'm going to run low on time, so I'm going to skip some of the stuff with, well, let me mention list DLLs. New option dash V allows you to see much more verbose information about the DLLs that are loaded in the process, and the dash U option is very valuable because it'll tell you, only show me the DLLs that are loaded in the target processes that are not signed, where the DLLs are not signed images. It's a good way to look for malware. Handle has gained zero new features, but the thing is that it uses the exact same kernel mode driver that Process Explorer uses. And so whenever the driver for Process Explorer gets updated, you need the new version of Handle as well. Otherwise, you're going to have conflicting drivers in memory. SigCheck, AccessCheck, and sDelete have been updated. The book is actually correct with sDelete, so I'm not going to mention that any further. SigCheck has a command line, doesn't have a command line option. It has a return code. So it returns a 0 or a 1 when it's done executing. It returns a 0 if all the files it checked out were digitally signed by a trusted publisher, and a 1 if any of the files that it inspected were not signed. So now you can use this in scripts to base a decision, like if everything was signed, then do this, otherwise take this alternate path. SigCheck has also added a lot more data to the information that it'll show you. SigCheck version 1.7.0, which was current when the book came out, if you did dash I, it would show you this, the subject of the digital signatures, this, the signing certificate and the chaining, the certificate chain of that signing of the signature. After Stuxnet and Flame started really abusing digital certificates, he added a lot more information. So now dash I will show you a lot more information about all the certificates in the signing chain, as well as countersignatures such as timestamps. This is a very new feature. When it inspected an unsigned file, it would show you the file date according to the file system, whatever the date was in the file system. And as you probably know, it's really easy for that to get modified, right? You copy it off of a different file system, you download it from the internet, you're getting the time you downloaded it, not the actual time that that file was built. For unsigned executable files, portable executable files, EXEs, DLLs, SCRs, OCX, etc., it now shows the link date. The link date is a date that's embedded within the file, so it's a lot less likely to be incorrect. It can be falsified, but not by accident. BG Info, still, if you run that, it's not been updated since Windows 8 came out, so if you run BG Info today on Windows 8, it'll tell you you're running Windows NT 6.2. All right? There is a new version in the works that will report Windows 8 correctly, but it hasn't been released yet. Desktops is a utility that lets you have multiple virtual desktops, and you can switch between them with different apps running on the different desktops. It works great on Windows 7. With Windows 8, with the new UI model, it didn't work anymore until they did a bunch of work to get it updated for Windows 8. And Zoomit, how many of you use Zoomit? I'm sure all of you see it all the time. Zoomit has some new options. For example, you can animate the zoom in and out. By default, you know, it goes in gradually and comes back out, so you can see the movement. You can turn that off, which is really useful when you're over an RDP connection, like a slow RDP connection. So now you turn that off, and it just snaps right in there. Another really useful feature is it now has an auto start entry point that you can configure from here. So if you want Zoomit running every time you start, every time you log in, you check this box, and it will start whenever you log in. I do want to get to DU, so let's get to that right here. Strings, you can download the slide and take a look at this. I do want to get to DU because it's gone through a major, major update, and I want to show you something that will be worth the price of admission to MMS this year. So DU shows you, here's the disk usage of this directory structure, right? DU-C is a relatively new option that will show you that as comma-separated values. And there's a new version of it that just came out that adds a bunch of new information. So instead of just instead of the information it used to show you, now it shows the path for each directory. Let me do a -V here, or -L2. So I'm going to go down two levels. For each directory, it now shows you how many files are in the current directory, what is the size of those files, what are the total count of files in this directory and below, the directory count in this directory and below, and the total size of that directory. But one feature I really like is now there's a -CT, which changes that into tab delimited. Why is that so exciting? How many of you are familiar with the clip utility? It's built into Windows. This is Clip has been built in, I think it was in Server 2003. It was a support tool, I think, in XP. It's now built into the operating system. This is one of those really rare command line utilities that is tremendously useful and isn't a Sysinternals utility. It's actually a Windows utility. What this does is whatever goes into its standard input gets copied to the clipboard. So the output you saw, pipe it to clip, it's now in the clipboard. What can you do with that? With tab delimited particularly, okay, Excel. And okay, so tremendously useful, like I said. Okay, much is left. Contig, how many of you have ever used Contig? Me neither. Whois is a utility, it's a fairly common type of utility. I'm sorry, I'm sure there's a use for it, but not where I work. Whois is a utility for finding who owns a particular domain name. It added a dash V option that shows you more verbose information about domain registration referrals, and I would love to show you a demo. Whois dash V, you have to do this on your own machine. Download the latest Sysinternals Whois and run Whois dash V Microsoft.com. The results are not appropriate for work. That's all I'll say. There's a lot of domains out there that have used the words Microsoft.com in their domain names in ways that our marketing department would never, ever, ever have approved. And if I show it to you here, it would cost me my job. So we'll skip that. Okay, so I do want to announce a new utility that just came out in the last week called RU. This is almost identical to DU. It's a registry usage utility that shows where in the registry all the data is being bloated up. Okay, so you have a lot of bloat in some particular registry key. RU will help you find where that is. First, I do want to show you RAM map. That thing's still running. I have an admin command prompt. RAM map is a utility that will show you how physical RAM is being allocated and what's in physical RAM. It has added options so that you can run it and immediately save the data right to disk without having to open up the GUI and click Control S or anything like that. One of the things I do want to point out is if you save one of these files on a 32-bit machine and then open it on a 64-bit machine, the formats for 64 and 32-bit RAM map files are different, so you need to specify -run32 when you're opening a 32-bit dump file, RAM map dump file. And yeah, I'm gonna, core info is something that shows all the features of the CPU, and it has just gotten a ton of stuff, and I have no idea what any of it means, but I get to put it in the book, so I get to learn all about it. Let me show you, though, RU. Just came out March 27th, shows per key registry usage. It has the exact same syntax as that of DU. So again, dash C for CSV, and if you do a CSV, it'll show you, a lot of information on a per key basis, how many values are in there, what the size of those are in bytes. And it does take into account things like the value name, which does take up space. You can recurse. You can go all the way through. Let me demo really quickly. We'll do RU. Now, how many of you are aware that you have this with PowerShell? Tab completion in PowerShell for registry keys. Okay, just the same. Exactly the same as with DU. And using this, you can find where in the registry you've got all the bloat. So I did mention that this is the fourth in the series of the Sysinternals primers. The other ones are available online, so you can go back and view them. The demos did not fail nearly as often at any of the previous tech eds. So if you want to see a good version of a Sysinternals primer, this is a good place to go. Sysinternals resources include the Sysinternals website. If you go to sysinternals.com, it'll redirect you to the TechNet site where the stuff lives. The Sysinternals blog, if you want to know whenever new updates have come out, go to the Sysinternals blog, subscribe to that, and whenever a new utility is updated in any way or a new one comes out, something comes out on the blog. Mark has a blog. The Windows Sysinternals Administrator's Reference, for the half a dozen of you who don't own the book yet, here are some links that you can use to go buy that. I have a blog, a couple blogs actually, and Andrew Richards has a blog as well as a lot of information about procdump and the features he's added to procdump. The defrag tools is a weekly show on channel9.msdn.com with Andrew and guests, and they show you a ton of debugging tips, debugging tools, and he's spent a lot of time on the Sysinternals utilities, and three of them just on the new features in procdump. He also has an article in MSDN Magazine from a few years ago about how to write a plugin for procdump version 4.0. Okay, so thank you very much for coming. I hope this was useful to you. If you have any questions, I'll be around up here for a while, so just come on up if you have whatever. So thank you again.